13. Verse, you can read from the screen. He took up also the mantle of Elisha that fell from him and went back and stood by the bank of Jordan. Judges. Judges, the 15th chapter, and the 15th verse. And he found a new jawbone of an ass, and put forth his hand, and took it, and slew 1,000 men therewith. Pick it up. Pick it up. Just pick it up. Pick it up. I'm convinced that there are people who are sitting in this waiting congregation who you're trying your best to be the best Christian. Amen. I know it's rough sometimes, but you're trying your best to be the best Christian that you could ever be. Make mistakes. You fall. You fail. But you're trying to be the best Christian, the best child of God. You're trying to walk with the Lord daily. You read your word, the Bible, on a daily basis. But then there are times you look back and you evaluate yourself and you find yourself looking at others. Sometimes you don't need to do that because God will give you exactly what he has given to someone else. You wonder why you are not as anointed as they are. But you see, the issue is they have labored, but what you didn't realize is that they had to pick up something. It just didn't fall from the sky. But it was at their reach, it was at their disposal, it was there. Do their part. They had to pick it up. But what you have gotten is that, yeah, they had to pick it up, but they had to put something down first. Before I could pick up the anointing, there's some things about me that God wanted me to put down. There's some things about my life that God wanted me to be finished with this. Sometimes he had to take some stuff away because I was too involved worshiping this. God said, well, now you're going to put this before me. Thou shalt not have no other God before me. I'm taking this from you. Sometimes you wonder why God has taken some things away. It is so that he can give you something better. Look at this text. I'm not going to keep you all day. We have Elisha and Samson. Two passages that we read. Elijah, one is about Elijah, and the other is about Samson. Two very different kind of men. But they had at least two things in common. They were both used by God mightily, or in a mighty way. If it's anything that you would ever say about them, regardless of the criticism, I just want it to be said that I have allowed God to use me. It doesn't matter what the world says, God has used me. It doesn't matter what your friends say. The most important thing is you allowing God to use you. And when God uses you, you can operate in his will and in his way and accord to his word. When God uses you, that means that you have set aside some things. When God uses you, it's when God has taken some unwanted things away from you. He has to cut around you, dig around you, to nurture you. They were both used by God in a mighty way. But both of them had something that they needed within reach. Just like you. But you have to pick it up. It doesn't matter how much glory, how much power, how much peace or joy, how much prosperity that surrounds you or is within reach. It doesn't matter. It doesn't help unless you pick it up.
Frustrated and bewildered about
your problem like your problem is the only problem that exists. Look, you got to look to the hill from whence coming your help, your help. I came to prophesy this morning. I came to speak to your life and tell you that the devil is not in charge of your life. I wish I had somebody here praying for me. And I don't care what it looks like, what it sounds like, what it feels like. Look at somebody and tell them, but God is still in control. Somebody need this word today. Oh, you've been walking around all week sad and perplexed and making everybody else miserable because you are miserable. And they said miserable love company. You've been in the company of another miserable person. But I came to tell you that God is in charge. He sits high. He looks low. And guess what? If there's a storm in your life, he's riding on top of the storm. He's controlling the storm just like he controlled the eye in Irma. I came to break the spirit of hopelessness and despair. Y'all, go lift your head up now, because I don't have no bad news. When I talk about Jesus, he's the only good news I know about. He's not all the old news, but he's new news. As a matter of fact, he's the newest news since news has been news. I came to cast out the spirit of fear. What are you afraid of? When you know that he's with you, he said, even David said, even though I walk through the valley and the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Why, David? God is with me. In life and in death. I said, God is with me. If I'm at the hospital, God is with me. On that job, God is with me. I'm not going home. Did you hear me? See, you got to convince yourself and start speaking to yourself. You got enough negative folks around you. You need a deliverance celebration. Well, you ask God, deliver me from all these negative folks trying to bring me down. You need a deliverance service because I'm not going under. You got to speak those things that are not as though they were looking. Somebody said, I'm not going under. I may be broke, but I'm not going under. Don't have a job, but I'm not going under. Because my God will supply. He shall supply all of my needs according to his riches. Everything belonged to him. It's not, David, it's not mine. It belonged to him. The fullness thereof. Gus, I got resources because I don't care about what man can do or cannot do. The earth is the Lord. And everything that's in the earth belongs to the Lord. What you think you own, it's not even yours. Quit claiming ownership. The earth is the Lord. That pocketbook you got. That's God. Those shoes with red bottoms you got on. That belongs to the Lord. That fine hat, that's not your hat. You keep it in that closet, that's his closet, but your hat that you call your hat, that's his hat. It's the Lord and the fullness thereof. Listen, let me talk about the church. Because that belongs to the Lord too. He said, upon this rock, I'll build Greg Sutton's church. Upon this rock, I'll build the preacher's church. Upon this rock, I'll build the deacon's church. I'll build a mother's church. He said, upon this rock, I will build my church. And see, the church is like the ark in the Old Testament. That's what the ark was. The flood waters rose until they cover the highest mountain. But guess what the ark did? The ark just rolled on top of the water. No matter how high the water got, the ark just rolled on top of the water. In other words, in the worst of time, the ark was lifted to its highest place. This is the finest hour for the church. Some said, but no, it's happening all over. It's universal. Bishop Paul said, people aren't attending church like they normally do. It's the finest hour. I couldn't see it at first, but I see it now. The Spirit showed me where this is the finest hour for, I'm talking about everybody's church. Because see, we were chosen by God to live right, first of all. Now, everybody's not living right, but we were chosen. That's why you get to hear this word. You were chosen by God to live right. Now, in this present season, and if God in all of his wisdom saw fit to allow us to live in this season. You missed that. I said, God saw fit. You could have been taken off the scene like your friends and your family, but God saw fit to allow you to be here in this season. You could have been in a car accident. You could have been in a fire, but God has allowed you for a reason, for a purpose. Just think about so many times he spared your life when danger was imminent and people around you looking, waiting just to shoot you down. But in this season, God allowed you to stay here for a purpose. I'm here. For a purpose. I'm here by through blood clots, through diabetes. I'm here for a purpose. I'm here. And you can't take that from me. You can't do nothing about that. I'm here for a purpose. God allowed me, to be here. I don't care what people said, how they talk and articulate. I'm here. Because God wanted me to be here for this season, because he believes in me. Guess what? It's getting ready to take place. I prophesied this 2 years ago. Miracles are getting ready to happen in this church. We've had enough folks dying, but miracles are getting ready to happen. We've had enough folks sick, but we haven't really seen no real miracles. Tell somebody, I need to see a real miracle in my life. We're about to enter into a season of breakthrough. When you pray and you see your prayers answered. I wish I had somebody here talking to me. If somebody's been praying and praying and praying, but guess what? God is getting ready to answer your prayer. Or you've been tossing and turning, but God said, I'm getting ready to answer your prayers. Oh my God, look at somebody tell them, I need God to answer my prayer now. This thing got to change. This stuff got to stop. I need something right now. I can't go on struggling like I'm struggling. I can't go on living like I'm living. God is getting ready to answer. Ready to come somebody else. I ain't got it yet in my pocket. I ain't got it yet. But look at what I said. But it's on the way. One thing I do know is coming. One thing I do know is on the way. The Bible says that if we are faithful over a the Lord will make us ruler over many things. See, God's just looking at how you handle little stuff. God's been looking at how you handle little blessings. God's been looking at how you handle folks who are trying to be loyal to you. God's just looking at how you handle things. And when he sees that you have handled this right, then he says, I can put you in charge of something much bigger because you showed me that you know what you're doing. But I'm going to give you a bigger blessing. Handle that! Somebody's about to rise up to the best Christian that you've ever been in your life. Tell somebody, we used to say, Lord, auntie, I want to be in this street a Christian. In my heart, this somebody, in my heart, I want to be a Christian. And I know you've been praying and you're asking the question, when is God going to do it? God is saying, pick it up. Somebody in this place this morning, you're about to get an answer to your prayer. And if you believe that, I need you to just shout, glory. Glory. And let me tell you why I know. You see, God put Ezekiel in the midst of a valley of dry bones, right? Because God knew that Ezekiel possessed the power to transform this situation. See, you got the Holy Ghost. You can transform some stuff. Help me, Holy Spirit. I said, you got the Holy Ghost. That means you can change some stuff yourself. You can change some stuff with the power that you have. You can speak to some mountains yourself. You can speak to some situation yourself. You can speak to some enemies yourself.
Some of them can see. And here we are.
job, you have a car, you can go to work. We would have been complaining about that little tropical storm that came through. It could have been a hurricane. What I'm saying, if God is for me, then who can be against me? The world is shaking. Tornadoes and storms and the economy. But we're in the world, but not of the world. Listen to this softly. We have an unshakable kingdom. Built upon an unshakable foundation, ruled by an unshakable God. Psalm 46, as I lead. Says, God is our refuge, 46 and 4. He's our refuge. What are you worried about? You made it the last time. You're going to make it. Give up on yourself, but don't give up on God. We got too many young folks committing suicide right now. He's your refuge. He is the word. He's your refuge and your strength. A very present help. He's my right now help. When I call him, he'll come right now. Step over the sea. Therefore, we will not fear. That's what it says, children. Though the earth be removed, though the mountains be carried away into the depths of the sea by volcanoes and landslides in California, though the waters roar and be troubled by a tropical storm, though the mountains shake. Whether they are, even while all of these bad things, if you notice in these last and evil days, these things are happening. We're living in the last days. Everything that the Bible said that would come is here. If that's not enough for you to get right with God, then something else has to take place in your life. David was saying, even though all these bad things I hear, the things that I hear in Atlanta, walk the street, found them dead, and park a lot of old Maxway. David said, even though we hear about these bad things, there is a river that is making glad the city of God. Meaning that God is still pouring out his spirit and his power. In other words, you can get through some of this stuff. This is not too hard. It might be too hard for you, but it's not too hard for God. There's some stuff you can make it through. There's some stuff you got to press your way. You can't just sit there like a wimp and say, please move mountain. You got to speak with authority. You got to stick your chest out. You got to be bold and point your finger at the mountain and say, be thou removed from me in the name of Jesus. Look at somebody and tell them, wait a minute, it's our time to shine. I'm almost. Tell them again, it's my time to shine. Isaiah 60 and 1 says, arise, and shine, for thy light is come, and the glory of God is risen on thee. Here's what you got to hear. For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth. Isn't it dark? Everything you hear is covering the earth. It's dark. It's getting dark. But people, the Lord shall rise upon you. He's getting up in somebody's spirit right now. And his glory shall be seen. In other words, God is going to get, oh my God, God's going to get in you, because it's real dark in the world. It's chaos. It's darkness. But God is saying, now, I got Saints and Jacks Memorial. They're sitting here this morning, and guess what? I'm going to put the spotlight on them. Oh, I wish I had a witness here. And when I put my spotlight on, Greg said, now, put my spotlight on you. You're going to see the glory of God on you. You know what? This is not the time to tone down. This is not the time to damper your praise. You don't have to worry about being politically correct or socially acceptable. This is the time to shine. This is the time that you ought to be up praising God like you want a breakthrough or not breakthrough. This is the time to rise and just praise God like you're going out of your mind. You got to choose you this day who you're going to serve. But as far as me and my house, tell somebody we will. I don't know, I don't know. I don't know about you, but I will serve the Lord. For serving the Lord will pay off after a while. Do I have any prayers? You don't mind walking down toward the altar and just let God know that I'm rising, I'm shining, and I'm going to give you the glory. I just need some praises to come on down and just lift up your hand. I need some praises. Who's not ashamed, you're not too proud. You're not too lifted up. You're not too cute that you can come on down. Despite what folks are free, they say about you, I don't know how you feel about it. But I need some praise. Who don't mind praying to God like a gold out of your mind. I need somebody to take off running. I need somebody to take off running. Advisor Kennedy, I don't want us to talk. Just praise God. Is there one? Somebody might have to sacrifice. God is going to give you double.